City of Champions now, you know.
Really, yeah.
Cleveland is now the City of Champions.
Soon to be.
Soon to be.
We should get a coach like Terry Francona.
That'd be a novel idea.
He wouldn't do well here.
We can have Francona, Tito versus Epstein. Yeah. Theo, there you go. You know, you think there'll be any animosity between the two of them?
Hi, Dennis. How are you?
John, how are you? Good to see you. How you doing?
I'm Zach Ventros.
Dennis Kelly.
Nice to meet you. I'm with Melissa Heath.
Frank Byron.
Yes, ma'am.
Dave's on the phone already.
Oh, Dave is.
Okay. Yeah, he's on the phone over here.
Dave, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Great. Hi.
Can you hear from far away, Dave?
I can, yes. Thank
Great,
you.
Thank you.
Okay, good.
Yeah, right. I can speak, but I can't hear.
Where did our chairman go? Yeah, let's kind of move it along, so.
How you doing?
Good.
Where's Dave calling in from?
City of Champions. Cleveland.
Cleveland, really?
I can't give him that title yet, Phil.
They still have the Browns there.
That's right. They don't claim them.
Water.
No, thank you, though.
To the audit committee first. Once you get done with the introductions, go instead of doing public comment, move the audit committee so these guys can
have Yes, it. Yep.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, good evening. This meeting of the Reading Municipal Light Department Board of Commissioners is being broadcast live at RMLD's office here at 230 Ash Street, Reading, Massachusetts. Live broadcasts are available only in Reading due to technology constraints. The meeting is being videotaped for distribution to community television stations in North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items on the official agenda, as well as items not on the official agenda. We do ask that all questions or comments from the public be directed to the chair, and that all parties, including members of the RMLD Board, act in a professional and courteous manner when addressing the board or responding to comments. Once recognized by the chair, all persons addressing the board shall state their name and address prior to speaking. It's the role of the chair to maintain order in all public comment or ensuing discussion. Just a couple of acknowledgments. Dave Hennessy will not be attending tonight. We also have Dave Talbot, one of our other commissioners, participating remotely. So all votes must be a roll call vote per the Massachusetts open meeting law. Dave Talbot, you're here?
Yes, I am.
Okay, thank you. Welcome. Okay, would also like to acknowledge our cab representative here this evening, Dennis Kelly. Thank you, Dennis.
Thank you.
And John Stempak, would you be board secretary this
evening?
Yes,
I'd be happy to. Thank you.
Okay. We'd like to actually start with I'm going to jump right into the audit committee, right?
Audit number five.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll have Frank Byron and Zachary Fentross from Melanson Heath PC to give us an update report,
okay.
Please.
All right.
Thank you.
My name is Frank Byron. I'm a president of Melanson Heath, and this is Zach Fentross, who is a supervisor who performed the audit here last month. I'd like to walk through the highlights of the June 30, 2016 financial statements, beginning with the first page after the table of contents, which is the independent auditor's report. We were hired to provide an opinion on the financial statements of the department, and this report is what we would consider to be an unmodified report. It's a clean opinion, which is the best opinion you can receive from an independent outside audit. In our opinion, these financial statements are in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. I would like to turn to just a couple pages in these financial statements to go over some of the highlights. If you could turn to page 6, which is the statement of net position. It summarizes the assets, the liabilities, and the equity of the department on June 30, 2016. Just an overall observation is, first of all, these numbers, these financial statements are comparative. They have the 2016 as well as the 2015 numbers in there. The numbers are very consistent from year to year. The numbers are all very strong. Overall, these financial statements show that the department is in a very strong financial position and is very consistent with where it's been in the past few years. There's a unrestricted cash balance, the first line on the top, of about $13 million, which is exactly where you were a year ago also. Very strong financial position there. Your receivables are about $8 million, which is not a large amount considering that your overall revenues are over $80 million. So it's really just over a month's worth of revenues are sitting in your receivables. The majority of this $8 million is actually unbilled, and there are very few delinquent accounts in here. So the department does a very good job at collecting its receivables. You also have some restricted cash balances of going down about 5 or 6 lines, restricted cash of $21.8 million and restricted investments of $1.3 million. There's a footnote later in the report on page 17, which provides a breakdown of those restricted cash and investment balances, but they're all very consistent with what they were in the prior year, and they're very strong balances to have on your balance sheet. One number that actually has changed the most out of all of the numbers in your financial statements is about a third way up from the bottom of the page. You'll see an account called net pension liability, and the amount is $8,833,549 compared to the year before, where it was about $4.5 million. So it's almost doubled from what it was in the year before. And this account is actually out of your control. The liability doubled since the prior year, primarily because the investment results of the town's retirement system did not meet what was anticipated, what the anticipated goal was for those earnings. The goal was 7.75% earnings, and the actual results was only 0.75% earnings. So because of that, it has a significant impact on the liability. So this is something that this is your proportionate share of the overall town retirement system liability. The town will be dealing with their proportionate share also of that same liability going up. Where you see that net pension liability, which is under the non-current liabilities, I just want to point out a couple things that do not appear on this balance sheet. One is bonds payable. There are no bonds payable, mm-hmm. Which again, is a very strong financial position for the department. All of the capital assets that have been acquired over the years, which are in excess of $72 million, is the net book value, have been acquired through the rate process over the year. So it's they've been paid for on an ongoing basis without having to issue any bonds payable. Also, there's no liability reported as a non-current liability for the what's called the OPEB, the other post-employment benefits. Because the department has been setting aside money into a trust fund equal to what the actuaries were suggesting you set aside. However, there's going to be a change in accounting standards in 2 years. In 2018, there's a new accounting standard. It's called the Government Accounting Standards Board Statement Number 75, which is going to replace the existing Statement 45, and it's going to require that the entire actuarially calculated liability for other post-employment benefits, which is health employment benefits for retirees, that entire liability be reported on your balance sheet, just as the net pension liability is now reported here. The unfunded amount, which does not appear on here, that will in 2 years is about $6 million. So if there's no additional funding of that in 2 years, there will be a $6 million liability reported on the balance sheet for the other post-employment benefits. If you could turn to the next page, which is the Statement of Revenues, Expenses, and Changes in Net Position. Again, the numbers are very consistent with the prior year. The revenues are up. In reality, though, the kilowatt hour sold was actually down about 2%, but the revenues went up because the cost to purchase your power went up. As a result, the revenues for that also went up. For the most part, other than that, most of the other revenues and expenses are all very consistent from year to year. The amount that your revenues went up is pretty much consistent with what your purchase power expense went up during a year. If you look at the third number up from the bottom, which is the change in net position, $3,369,404, that's your net income. So your revenues beat your expenses by $3.3 million, very comparable with the prior year, which was $3.2 million. And the state sets limits on the amount of net income you can have, and the limit is at 8% of the value of your capital assets, your fixed assets. So this number, 3.3 million, is almost at that maximum. It could have been up about another $300,000 or so, but that would be the upper limit. So you've been very consistent in having a very strong bottom line, and those are the revenues that you set aside for capital purposes in the future, and that's the reason why you haven't had to issue any bonds payable as you make your infrastructure additions. I'd like to turn to page 10. Page 10 deals with what's called fiduciary funds. These are monies that are set aside for future pension costs as well as future OPEB, other post-employment benefit costs. For your pension trust, what you put into it, which came from your operations, was comparable with what got paid out of this pension trust to the town's retirement system, both about $1.5 million. So that leaves about $5.6 million set aside in this trust fund. The OPEB trust, which is the right-hand column, took in about $308,000 from your operations, which is the amount that your actuaries recommended you set aside, and that's the exact amount that you put into this. That added to a little bit of investment results of about $14,000, comes out to an increase for the year of about $322,000, which means you have $2.5 million set aside for these OPEB costs. However, as I mentioned earlier, there's an additional unfunded $6 million, which will have to be reported in 2 years on your balance sheet, assuming that there no more gets set aside into this OPEB trust. So that summarizes your financial statements. You had a very good operating results for the year, very consistent with the prior year. All your numbers are very strong. Your cash balances are. Your receivables are in very good shape. Very little debt. Really, the only liability that increased is the only account that's out of your control, being the net pension liability. So the department did a very good job also in closing its books. We audit a number of June 30 year-end municipalities, and this is the first one that got completed this year. So the department should be commended for closing its books in a very timely manner and being prepared for the audit and being able to actually complete the audit here in mid-October. The accounting records are in very good shape for the department. They do a very good job. And this year was a little bit different because there was a change in the finance department. Your business manager had some turnover at the end of the year, but the department did a very good job between the previous manager and your new manager worked together to help us with the audit to provide all the information that we needed, and they did a very good job.
Good. Any questions from the board?
Excellent. Thank you.
One recommendation from the audit committee?
Yes, please. Okay. Phil, would you
let me just report? Give you a report of the audit committee. Both the audit committee of the board itself here, which is Mr. Stempak and myself, plus the audit committee of the town, there were four members there, which are myself, the representative from the Board of Selectmen, the representative from the Finance Committee here in town, and there is one at-large member who was attended. So we did. There was a quorum of four people. Both boards recommended that this commission accept the audit as presented. The vote of the board was 2-0. The vote of the town audit committee was 4-0 to accept this. So, and you've heard kind of the reasons why from Frank already.
Good.
Okay. With that, Mr. Chairman, I can make a motion if you're,
yes,
you're so inclined.
Please.
Okay. I will move that the Board of Commissioners accept the audit report from Melanson & Heath for the fiscal year ended June 30, 2016, as presented.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? None appearing.
Roll call vote.
Roll call vote.
Ms. Pacino, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Mr. Talbot.
Dave Talbot.
You there, Dave?
Yep.
Okay. He may have put himself on mute. Yeah. That's a possibility, okay, too.
We're doing a roll call vote to...
Okay.
Yep.
Aye.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Dave. Okay. Motion carries 401.
40.
40.
40.
Yeah, we have one absence.
Right. Okay.
Very good.
Good. Good. Thank you, Frank. And
thank you for having us.
We appreciate you coming, and see you next year.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. At this time, I don't know, but I'll ask anyway if we have any public comment. Does not appear to be any. So.
No. Okay.
All right. So we'll move on. Next report of the chairman. So the only item which I'll ask for. A follow-up from Mr. Talbot. So we are members of the Northeast Power Association, and we had representatives there at their annual meeting. I think we briefly reported last meeting about some concerns regarding one of the speakers on climate change and denial of same. So we've actually received a response from NEPA, and as board chair, I'll be sending a closure response to that. But I'd ask Dave, did you have a statement you also wanted to make regarding that communication? Dave Talbot?
Yep.
Okay, Dave, I don't know if you're having trouble hearing. Could you hear? I was just acknowledging that we received communications back from NEPA regarding the speakers conference, and that I would be addressing,
yep,
that. And I also just wanted to give you the opportunity to see if you had any comments. I know you were at the conference as well.
Nothing more than what I said last month, which was just that because they brought in somebody who kind of presents non-factual information.
A little louder, Dave, if you can. We're not hearing it.
Okay. Just because they had presented non-factual information about a very important topic,
yep.
I had replied to them asking, you know, them to sort of recognize that, and they wrote back to me, and I sent you that letter, which you then shared with the rest of the board.
Right.
And then I think at this point it would be good to just have a board response and sort of just bring the matter to a close of the board.
Yeah, I acknowledged earlier that I would send a closure response. So.
Okay, great. Well, thank you.
Okay, good.
I appreciate it. I'm very pleased that we're all willing to do this.
Good.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Any other discussion from the board on that topic? Okay, thank you, David. So next.
Thanks, Tom.
You're welcome. Next, we wanted to get a report on the recent CAB Citizens Advisory Board Committee meeting. So, Dennis, if you had any update on that or any...
I don't think there was anything earlier. We talked about a solar program going on.
Yeah.
One of the questions everybody had was how many of the board members were going into the program, buying into it. So, that's good. We're all curious.
Dave Talbot, are you signed into the solar program?
Say again?
Have you signed up yet for the solar program?
I have. Well, I told Tom Alula that I wanted, I have 2 meters in my house. I want it on both meters.
Okay.
Signed up
twice. Okay. We're only going to count one vote, but thank you for doing that.
Yeah, that was one of the questions that I...
Give me one and a half votes.
Okay.
Nothing really new.
Okay. I talked to Dave since I knew he wouldn't be here. He did mention, and I don't know if maybe there's a quick comment we can cover now. Apparently, there was some discussion about replacing David Cuso,
a
Reading representative.
Yeah.
So I don't know, is the process, does anyone, Dean, do you know what the next step is in that process, whose action item that should be?
It should be the town's.
Well, I mean, it's up for someone to put their name in the hat. I mean,
yeah.
I guess that's what it comes down to. They
yeah.
have to apply to the town.
Yeah. Is there, how do we acknowledge the vacancy? Is that anything we need to do for, or the CAB needs to do?
Yeah, I mean, I would suspect the town has probably posted that. Anybody who wants to come out, please come out,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah.
You know, right. I mean, that would be nice to have, a representative from Reading on that board. I mean, the idea of the CAB is to represent the ratepayers of the town of Reading, and that's what those people, and that's why the CAB is there, to give us input. And so, you know, by not having a representative, in essence, you know, Reading's customers are really not represented. So please, somebody come forward.
Okay, I think that's being broadcast throughout the town of Reading.
Yes.
So, thank you. Okay.
The other concern is if, for some reason, one of us or two of us couldn't make it,
right.
we can't even get a quorum.
Right.
So
exactly.
missing a person
yep.
becomes an issue.
Yep.
So.
Yeah, I spoke briefly to Dave, and I think he was had a couple of possible recommendations that we'll serve those up as appropriate.
Yeah.
Yes,
I have, because I meet with the town managers and then on to the selectmen twice a year.
Yep.
So those meetings, Jeannie's made all the meetings in November with all the town managers, so I'll reiterate that at my meeting.
Great.
And it doesn't take a lot of special training to be on the CAB. No offense, Dennis.
No, it doesn't.
No offense, but it doesn't take a lot of special training. It doesn't really need any, just the general knowledge, you know, and you could represent the ratepayers here in the town of Reading, and that's what, that person to come forward.
Yep. Good. Thank you, Phil.
Okay.
All right. Any other discussion on CAB meeting? Good.
No,
thank you,
good.
Dennis. Okay. At this time, we shall move on to General Manager's Report. Colleen, please.
Yes. Good evening. Thanks. Just a couple of comments. We recently had the RMLD open house, which I know was very well attended. And it was held this past two Thursdays ago on October 6th in conjunction with National Public Power Week. It was a great success. We're always looking for feedback, to make each year better. This year, I think we had a lot of educational tools, and I know the kids liked the linemen and the technician displays and the bucket truck rides, but we're constantly trying to add things about solar. We had the And we just recently did something on the electric vehicles and all of the types of rebates and programs that we offer. So, you know, all four towns should be very proud that we have, you know, our own utility. And, you know, we just want to make sure that we're getting the word out, and anything that we can do, all the ideas are appreciated. So.
Yeah, no, I had the chance to come by for a short time. It was really well done, and it's a great family day. There's a lot of kids and grandkids, and they actually installed during the course of the day, they installed a pole, right? They,
yep.
They erected a,
yep.
A telephone pole, and so it was...
It's educational and tactile. The kids love the tactile. But I'm going to skip ahead just a little bit with going to our revised art contest. And we used to run a t-shirt contest, and now we're running an art contest. We're going to reutilize a lot of the frames. We're going to recycle them. There's a lot of probably paintings and drawings and prints that have been faded, and we just want to make sure that we're recycling everything. So instead of doing the t-shirts, we've provided the third graders, all the third grade schools, with watercolor paper and watercolor pencils. We put in all kinds of educational materials, and you'll notice when I come to the town meeting in Reading and our annual report that's coming out, our theme this year is going to continue with Shaving the Peak, except now it's going to be called Shred the Peak, mm-hmm. and with some skateboarders that are shredding off the top of the peak to show that if we all conserve during, you know, those periods where we send it out on Twitter and yeah. we send all the notifications out, that we can offset a lot of the cost by doing that. We want to roll that into that educational program with the children, you know, similar to the way recycling was brought into the children. You know, they get their parents to recycle, next thing you know, we're all recycling and we don't even realize it. And so we want to try to get them to do the same type of thing with Shredding the Peak. So we're going to be having some, not bumper stickers, but the, you know, the little decals that you can put on your car and they come off easily, to try to get this, you know, maybe this new catchy phrase of helping the kids to help them conserve during those higher cost periods, so that we can try to keep the cost down for everyone. The schedule for the art contest will run the same as the t-shirt contest. All of the materials have already been sent out to the schools and the education, and we'll be having it in January, correct? That's, I don't have a date,
your
but it's usually,
well, that's, you
is
know,
it usually
they
around
the
first,
them all.
On the 9th and
the
10th, the
10th of
okay.
January. And then the winners, we actually bumped up the awards to the winners.
Good.
We increased the amount of winners. And we increased the amount of money that would go to the winner for that art department. And their artwork, will make copies of them and display them in the frames so that their parents can come see it. And I think it'll be as exciting of a night as the t-shirt. And we'll yet to see. We'll have to have Phil decide which one's better, since he's been doing the t-shirt for...
How many years, Phil?
22 years.
As long as we've had the contest. Does it say art critic on your business card?
Yeah. Now, our board commissioners, fair game, can they be painting one?
No,
of
but you
no,
can
no,
be
no.
a judge.
Okay.
And
no, I mean
actually,
for the kids to paint the...
Paint the commissioners?
Yeah.
Come on.
Well,
we're actually looking at a phase two of this, where we might roll this into the high school as well. We have to work with the teachers. But the high school, you know, the mediums that they use, you know, maybe photography and things of that nature, we might be able to capture more art and be able to, you know, do a couple more awards. And as long as we're keeping, you know, the whole system educated, I think eventually, I mean, this year, you know, through all of our media and everything, we were able to save in conservation, and I think if we keep going, I think it'll be something that we'll all be proud of, and we know we'll be working hard to keep our rates as low as possible.
Another nice community event. So you'll create a calendar as well?
Yeah, the actual historic calendar, the final proof is currently being done, and the calendars will be out in November, correct?
Yep.
Okay,
but also,
great.
Don't you do a calendar for, you did one from the t-shirts?
Well, there's a t-shirt calendar like this, and we'll just display the artwork instead of the t-shirts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
And the kids will get their artwork framed, you know, just a nominal frame to be able to send home, so that they have something to keep similar to a t-shirt.
Nice. Yep.
But I think it'll be fun. And if you if you've never used watercolor pencils, you use the pencils and then you use water to make it into watercolors. It's really kind of fun. So we'll see how that goes.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Good.
Okay. The holiday tree lighting is from November 27th from 2 to 4:30. And we typically replace some of the strands.
You write it in the Reading Center.
Reading Center.
Yes.
And we typically replace some strands for each of the towns.
We haven't this year at all.
Well, if they get if each of the towns, if we've given them so many lights, if they have lights that have gone out or whatever, we'll replace them. So we just need to know. You know what I mean? We don't want to be okay. Well, we'll just keep giving them so that next thing you know we're doing a 5 mile area. But we want to be able to. You know, help.
We're still paying for those kilowatts. It's a good thing.
Right. Yeah, but now that they're LED lights that we give you, anyways, we'll look at if you
know. Yeah,
so take a look
DPW.
At the lights with George and see what you have, and you know, we'll go through each town and you know.
Who strings the lights for the town?
Usually the DPW strings the lights. I mean, we come and you know work with Santa and you know hit the switch. I tell you a quick funny story, though. This is very funny, since I never tell funny stories. The first year I came here, and I'm up at the Reading lighting ceremony, and there's this ladder against the tree. And I was like, oh, God, that's a safety violation. So I was going to go remove the ladder.
that's
the ladder that Santa climbs, but it wasn't.
You wanted a chimney up the
tree? Can you imagine?
The Grinch.
The Grinch is Christmas.
I just looked at it like, oh, some kid's going to climb in that and get hurt. I better go take that down. And I'm starting to walk, and they're like, and here comes Santa. I'm like, oh, no.
Well, I think Santa wears lineman boots.
It's always a fun event, and the Reading is always very beautiful. As I mentioned before, the meetings with the town administrators and the selectmen, that starts in November. And so I'll provide some updates as we go through each of the towns. But, you know, we'll be talking about typical things like North Reading did decide. I got a letter from them. The lights that were shut off are going to be turned back on. So this is good news. So we can continue with our LED. So they'll want to know what's going on with the LEDs and the credits for all of the streetlights. And then we'll talk about the double poles, which is always interesting. I mean, we're replacing a lot of the poles, but we'll look to the towns to help make sure that all the transfers, that as the transfers go to Ball in your court, that they're making the transfers, and Verizon and Comcast. You know, each town has some topics that they like to talk about with the electric utility. So, but I'll give you some feedback on that as I make my way through those meetings. The quarterly update of the organization and reliability report, I'm going to turn that over to Hamid. He did a great job with the cab, so we'll...
Good evening.
Good evening.
I don't have any funny stories to tell you, but I'll give you... Well, if you recall, back in 2015, we did a study, organization on reliability study. Organizational study was done by Leidos in Engineering, and the engineering study, 20-year planning study, was done by Booth and Associates. And the result of the study for the organizational study was basically 17 areas they picked up that they required some attention, and they made recommendations. For the Booth study, they picked up 45 immediate area that needed to be addressed, and the time frame for those 45 were from 2015 all the way to 2026. So, within that 10-year or short-term study, they made 45 recommendations, which we combined them with the UPG, the company that tested the substations. We also picked up some issues at the substations because, as you recall, the substation had been maintained for over 10 years. The system has not been maintained for over probably 15 years or 20 years. So we need some work to do. So those recommendations, the first one I'm going to go over is the reliability study recommendations. You see the first 45 recommendations are Booth. The rest up to 71 are basically the UPG combined together. The ones that, you know, we have completed since the inception of this program, we have completed 22 that to date is completed. Seven of those 22 are newly completed since the last report. And those are the ones that are in red. You see that item number 1, 3, 4, 13, and 62, 63, and 67. So we are, I'm pleased to announce that we are on target, basically, and on track to addressing these deficiencies. And a lot of them, they're in progress, that we are making more repairs and more fixes that they're coming about. And we are on time on this, basically. So if you have any questions on the reliability and 20-year planning study, I'll be more than happy to address those. Otherwise, this is basically what was done since the last
year. I think the progress, a lot of attention units on it.
Thank you. Okay. We're getting a lot done, really. It is great. Any questions on those? Awesome. Okay. The next report is the organizational study updates. As I mentioned, there are 17 areas that they picked up. The goal was to compare our RMLD business model, compare that to the best business practices. Basically, a few areas in a nutshell that they picked up. There's some of those were skills deficiencies, the organizational efficiency, productivity. Which as a result of those, they gave us some recommendations, such as they were providing divisional roadmap, need for restructuring, and restructuring requires beefing up the skills assessments, as well as the job descriptions, and revamping the CDP or creating a CDP that they go hand in hand. And then category one, the planning, basically it's ongoing. For the new organizational setup with the roadmaps provided is requiring the need for new strategic planning to be done in 2017. The last one was done in 2008. As a part of the recommendations were that, you know, well, present a six-year annual plan, and we are doing that annually. We're presenting that to the board, that 6 years of spending, so you know what's coming down the pike and what the spending is going to be for the fiscal year. IRD group, the integrated the resources department, they have a plan in progress. That's they're working on that. The system planning, basically, that includes the GIS technology roadmap and 20-year planning study. It's done, so that's and we are with the GIS. We're making progress in order to complete the model. The second category, the workforce development, basically it requires Leidos support. Currently we're working on the job descriptions. All the managers, they're doing that. And they go hand in hand with the CDPs that we present that to Leidos. They review that, and then they make adjustments as necessary compared to the future needs. The succession planning, we did that, part of that, and part of that it's being implemented. We're still doing the succession planning for various jobs. We also have some vacancies that we need to fill out. They're hiring the HR. The other vacant positions are two system engineers, staff accountant, and assistant business finance director. So those are the vacancies that they still needs to be filled out as a part of that restructuring and recommendations. The third category is improving, they recommended improving the organizational effectiveness. And this is really tied to the IBEW negotiations that it's underway. As you know, anytime you change the job descriptions and the CDPs are altered, now we're gonna have to go and, you know, present that to the union. And in the heavily union-dominated environment, that kind of slowed down the process. So the reorganization of IRD department, it's done. Engineering and business finances are in progress. We also, as a part of the recommendation for organizational effectiveness, they recommended developing the internal and external communication plan. That is work in progress. And we've done that. Some of the external communications, such as tweeting and other measures, emailing, sending 18,000 emails to the customers for load shedding and stuff like that, you know, that's been done. We still got more programs that they're going. The internal communication plan, as I'm going to mention in a few more later on, this is, you're going to see that the meetings that we have provided for the opportunity for the employees, so they know exactly what's going on, and the managers, they meet with their staff and bring them up to date with the new developments. The fourth recommendation they made was developing the leadership capabilities that, again, is tied to the union contract. As we assess the IRD group, business finance department, and engineering division employees, some have been assessed internally, some combination of Leidos and internal assessments. The leadership training, it's ongoing. Again, that's tied to the CDPs. They are going hand in hand. Staff meetings to improve internal communications. All the managers, they meet with their employees on a weekly basis. We do. In my group, I meet twice a week with them to make sure everybody is on the same page. And, you know, if there are any immediate needs, immediate issues that need to be addressed, we address those meetings. We cover basically everything. We go over the 20-year plan. Break down those into the goals, objectives, and the ones that, you know, we need to meet for every year. We go over those, and basically everybody is going to be brought up to date, and the tasks are assigned to the employees, and I monitor the progress. So that's so much for that. Also meetings with the communities, that as Colleen mentioned, that, you know, we meet twice a year with the communities to bring the community up to date with all the activities that department is involved. The fifth category is establishing the project management culture. This is ongoing. We are developing project management policies and procedures, everybody from the manager all the way to the or employee level. All the subordinates, they're going to go through project management training. So we are managing time and resources, making sure that we are on target with the projects and monitoring the budget. The HR is going to provide that training through ECNI or NEPA organizations, that, you know, so everybody is trained on the project management and beefing up that skills. The sixth category is ensuring competitively priced services. This is continuous cost of service rate design review that Jane Group is doing, and educating customers on the time of use, demand side management, the solar programs, and all the renewable energy resources, the plans. And those plans, they're doing a phenomenal job. I mean, this year, you know, such as the community solar, the choice, and that you're involved, and this is really great. It's a good opportunity for the customers to get involved and be participating. The seventh category is improved financial planning and risk management. We are reviewing and updating the reserve policies of operations, depreciations, fuel, OPEB, and sick buyback program. We are also, they recommended formalizing the financial and accounting business processes, which is in progress. The eighth category is strengthening the safety culture, which is ongoing. We're continuously reviewing the board safety policies, and we're developing safety programs. Right now, we've got two safety committees. One is for operational, which is me, and also another one is the general safety meeting for the rest of the company. Everybody has an opportunity to participate in that process and make the environment safe and make recommendations to improve safety and be involved. The ninth category is diversity resources, which is ongoing. We developed a roadmap for DGs. Jane and I, we worked together to put a 10-year, 15-year plan for solar, battery storage, and gas generations. Obviously, those recommendations and planning that we do, they're continuously being reviewed and assessed, depending on financial availabilities and other factors. The other recommendation was the reviewing the cost effectiveness. We evaluate all the programs annually, and we're making the necessary adjustments as needed. The tenth category was establishing a culture of compliance, which requires Leidos support. the Leidos is developing a plan for the QC/QA management, and that was one of their recommendations, which once you start implementing the program and once the all the programs are implemented, now we're going to have to go back and reassess to see how well that program, you know, been implemented and whether, you know, we need to make any other adjustments or not. QC control. The 11th category is improving the customer service. We are developing this service survey plan that's ongoing, also developing the customer communication plan by mid-2017, and we're working on that. The 12th category is planning for the future technologies. We have completed a technology roadmap, and that's for the next 15 to 20 years, which goes hand in hand with the 20 years system planning study. And again, we're gonna review those continuously, and any adjustments we need to make, we need, because technology is evolving and advancing, so to make sure we stay up to date with that. IRD roadmap developed and being reviewed continuously by Jane's group. Item number 13, they recommended to focus on asset management, which is ongoing. We're developing asset management plan, which really requires integrating the Cogsdale and GIS in order to be able to do a good job and tracking those. Developing the asset management tracking, this is not going to be done until the GIS done. GIS next year is going to be completed by June of 2016. And once that's completed, now we can, all of the nice maintenance program, the 10 programs that we've developed, now we can track them on date and then follow up with the next series of the maintenance work that needs to be done. And we can do the cost-benefit analysis and see how well we are doing. So that's so much for that. We developed the customer service manual. The customer service manual, basically, it's completed. It's on the website. The customers now, they can refer to those and their area of responsibilities as well as the utility responsibilities. And it's a good guideline for all the customers to know what they should do and what how much they're going to be paying for new constructions or any upgrades or any there for the services, as well as the construction practices that are acceptable, and they're based on, basically, they're designed based on the National Electric Safety Codes and to follow the codes properly. Number 14 is the GIS. As I mentioned, we're conducting the robust GIS-based inventory system in 2017. That's in progress. The CDM and Davies, these are the two contractors that are collecting the GIS data and developing the GIS model. Once the data is completed and model is developed, then we're going to convert that to another model for engineering use that we can, every year, we can review and analyze and adjust the planning and the designs and moving forward, just to make sure we respond to the system needs in more professional and more scientific way. So that's going to create a smoother path for that. Training the engineers to follow after the GIS and the model completion, they're going to be using the MILSOFT model for their analysis and engineering studies. And because a number of engineering studies are recommended to be done in order to, you know, 20-year plan, it's great model, it's a good Bible to have, it's a guideline, but not everything is spelled out, so there's some work that internally needs to be made in order to make sure we stay up to date and we stay current with the current engineering practices. So that's done. The 15th category is the work management business process. That's in progress. Developing a plan and implementing the integrated work order management system that puts it all together, MIS, CIS, and billing system, and GIS, they're all going to be integrated together, and that's a plan down the road. Leidos right now, it's assisting us to develop the IT plan long-term and short-term, so to address the IT needs, making sure that, you know, we're not doing any redundancies and everything, you know, it's cost-efficient and they're keeping track of the productivity and efficiency.
Amit, does that require a new business system to run the
Well, part of it, yes, we are going to need some new softwares in order to bring all of these two together. But like I already said, we have a big roadmap for the technology roadmap that gives in the big picture approach, like a big puzzle, the pieces. And one piece is this IWMS that we need to address, and we need to. We got a Harris system. Harris system is capable of handling the work order management system. However, they're a little bit behind the technology because they don't talk, multi-speak with like, so integration with the other subsystems, it's gonna create some difficulties until they catch up to the technologies. But since this is the software we're using for our accounting and billing, so we kinda need to stay with that and use that for as a base.
Good, thank you.
You're welcome. The 16th area was a plan for resiliency that's completed. We completed the disaster recovery plan. That's emergency operating procedure. We have a number of procedures that Colleen has directed all the managers to prepare. That's operational procedures. We have them all on a website right now, so everybody can access. Before that information was scattered. Now that's all on the Do you jump in?
It's not on website, it's on SharePoint.
Oh, the SharePoint, I'm sorry. Yeah, I used that wrong. Yeah, it's not the website, it's on a SharePoint, internal SharePoint, that all the employees, they can use that and refer to that, which is nice, organized. Every department has its own, basically, area that they go in and share the information, bring in, which is really nice. Now, we are all more organized than, and the information are all in SharePoint for everybody to use.
As part of the recovery, disaster recovery, is right. there a recovery site? So if the building wasn't accessible, is there actually a, how is that managed, or is that covered in the recovery?
If this building is not accessible, we're going to...
Your computer system and stuff like that, so is there a redundancy?
We got... We got backup in the clouds. We got some, for the data is going to be backed up. But as far as the,
Do you have any service? Do you have any service here? Software service, or is it all web-based and cloud-based?
Some of them, they're cloud-based. We're making the transition to cloud-based, but we're not fully cloud-based yet. For instance, for the ITRON metering and the billing system, that's going to be going on cloud, iCloud. So because ITRON keeps... terminating basically their obligation to maintain the systems because they don't want to update the older systems like the Windows 2003. It's not supported any longer. So now they making us to go to 2007. Now the server for that, it's not going to be no longer going to be supported by 2016. So now and then 2016. They're going to make us to go to, by 2020, to another subsystem. So we said, okay, 2011, you stopped supporting that 2003 version. Now 2016, you're going to terminate the 2007, and now going moving forward. So we can't keep upgrading the servers and, keep up with their demand of upgrading. It's going to be costly. So we're going on to the iCloud. And send the data to iCloud. As far as operating the other stuff like SCADA system, what we've done, we have created a security zone that we can remotely connect only authorized people with multiple authentication factors that only certain authorized people, they can access that, and we can operate the system remotely in case of the disaster.
Good.
So the 17th category is enhancing the facilities, which is ongoing. We completed the fleet study, and we continuously monitoring the progress in that area, and also any changes that's going to be reviewed annually for any need. That concludes the report for the organizational and reliability studies. Any questions? Colleen, if you have anything more to add.
Oh, I just...
Okay.
We got to be careful about what security things we discuss.
Right.
That's all.
Bye.
Good.
That's why I got one of these.
That's why you got one of these.
lots of good activities going on. Any other questions from the commissioners?
No.
Okay.
It's great.
Thank you.
Okay. Jane, I think you're up. Power supply report.
Nice job, Hamid.
Yes. I was wondering how many numbers there were up to 17.
All good stuff. I was following them on the sheet here, yeah.
No, it's all very good. So.
Thanks. I'm here to report on the August power supply. I have just three graphs that we looked. We looked at a lot of graphs last month. We looked at the heating degrees and cooling degrees, and we talked about peak demand. So what we tried to do, because August was a peak month for the ISO, a preliminary peak month, we believe we peaked on August 12th at 4 p.m. We looked at what I wanted to look at historically is over the last 3 years, the ISO's peak versus RMLD's peak. And as you can see, we're a very, very, very small portion of the ISO. We represent about less than 1%, about 0.6%, when you look at our load over the total load. So these are the numbers and how we fit within the ISO markets. So we looked at 2014, the ISO peaked on July 23rd at 5 p.m. In 15, it was July 29th at 6 p.m. And this year, it was August 12th at 4 p.m. And then our load corresponded. This is the only year, this year was the only year that we had a coincident peak with the ISO. So in these other years, we were peaking at different hours. But again, when we are forced to carry our capacity obligation for the year, what we're targeting is the coincident load with ISO New England. And so that's why when we had our Shave the Peak campaign, we called it 10 or 11 times because we're targeting the ISO's peak and not necessarily RMLD's peak. So this was relatively in line. If you look at the all 3 years, we're about 0.64% of every year. So in moving forward, our target in order to achieve some meaningful results, we want to make sure that we have a significant amount of decrease so that we reduce that percentage. And so that's how we're benchmarking how well we're doing. This next graph looks at real-time pricing on peak during the peak month for 2014, 15, and 16. It was kind of interesting because over the last two summers, the two previous summers, 14 and 15, real-time prices were relatively flat. If we looked at the last slide, the average ISO peak was around $24,300 for both of those years. This year, the peak went up around 5%, so we were at a little over $25,000. And as a result of that 5% increases, prices became very volatile. So the average price exceeded over $300 a megawatt hour. And if you look at today's prices, they're around $20. So there was significant price volatility in the real-time markets for the month of August. And you're probably commenting, well, how did that affect RMLD? Because that's what I said. I said, if I'm a commissioner, I want to know how that affected. So what we did is we looked at our portfolio cost and our average fuel costs. And this graph actually depicts our sales. So because it was a hot month, our sales totaled over 69 million kilowatt hours for the month of August, considerably higher than the two other previous peak months for the years. But our average cost because of that was down to just a little over 4.3 cents. And how that happens is because we have the portfolio of resources. And if we're able to manage those accordingly, if some of our generators, because of the pricing that they get bid into the market, are being dispatched more than what our load is, we actually get paid for that. So during some of those $300 hours, the RMLD was a net recipient of funds as opposed to paying the high costs. And that's the advantage of having the portfolio. And these costs are passed along to our consumers through our fuel charge, and that fluctuates. And we've been maintaining level to lower fuel charges as a result of all this.
That's fantastic.
Great. Yeah.
Good chart. So those are the three charts that I depicted for the month of August.
Mm-hmm. Great.
I also have the solar choice rate?
Yes.
If that's okay.
Yeah,
Tom?
Let me just, this is, was mentioned in a CAB meeting in October 12th and approved. I have a letter, October 12th, approved by the Citizens Advisory Board. So why don't you?
Thanks. So over the last year or so, RMLD has been working on a community shared solar project. What we're trying to do is because certain customers are unable to purchase solar and place them on their roof, if they're renters, if their house isn't facing the right direction, or if it's just cost prohibitive, we wanted to look at the option of doing a community solar project. So we were able to secure a project within our service territory. It's a 1 megawatt or 1,000 kilowatt project. It's on Ballardville Street in Wilmington. And the way we've set up this solar choice rate is that we're looking for 500 customers. We're limiting the first project to 500 customers. And those customers will receive the cost and the benefit of that solar project. So the cost of the energy is fixed for a 20-year term. So when customers sign up for that, they're in fact fixing a portion of their fuel charge over the next 10 years. And currently in the first year, the cost of the solar is slightly higher than the cost of our fuel charge. So there's a small premium associated with the solar choice, and it works out to be $5 per month. So every customer who signs up for the first 12 months on the solar choice, there'll be a line item on your bill that will say solar choice, and then the first, it'll be $5. After, on month 13, we're currently forecasting that there will be a $3 to $4 credit. And again, the solar on the system achieves a benefit during our peak period. And that capacity benefit and that transmission benefit goes directly to the customers who have signed up for this rate. So it's a complete pass-through from RMLD. The customers who sign up for this program receive the benefits and the risks associated with that. And so over the course of a 10-year period, it's currently forecasted that a customer who signs up for the Solar Choice program will receive a net benefit of approximately $300. So it costs $60 for the first year, and then those costs are made up, if we say $3 to $4 per month. In the third year, shortly after the third year, you're going to be net positive. So it's a very great program. We've had, we sent out an email campaign last Friday alerting customers of the benefits and what they needed to do, and we are almost at the goal. So what we're going to plan on doing is limiting it to 500 customers. When we get more, there's going to be a waiting list, and then that will determine the phase two or the next project that the RMLD should begin to. So if you haven't gone onto the website, I know all the commissioners have. I encourage our customers to go onto our website, click on the Solar Choice, and to sign up, because we're almost fully subscribed.
Good. Any questions for Jane on the rate? Okay, I think we have a motion.
Yep.
I'll move that the RMLD Board of Commissioners approve Solar Choice Rate MDPU 269 to be effective on billings effective after December 1st, 2016, on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Not appearing. We'll have a roll call vote.
Ms. Pacino, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke,
aye. Mr. Talbot, aye.
Yep. Mr. Stempak, aye.
Okay. The motion carries 4-0.
Yep.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jane.
You're welcome.
Good job. Good pictures. Amid, would you like to come up again?
By all means. I would love it.
This is a different topic, though, right?
I hope so. Jane. Thank you. I'm proud to present the engineering operations report for month of August 2016. The first slide, you see the capital improvement projects. For the month of August, we spent $54,385. That brings the year to date to $94,196. These are the capital improved projects approved by the board. The next category is the routine constructions. For the month of August, we spent $191,849. That brings the year to date to $324,827. The next slide is the maintenance, the routine maintenance. These are the number of maintenance programs that we initiated, and we tracking those for maintaining the system. And the transformer replacement category through the month of August, we replaced 21.24% of the pad mount transformers in overhead, approximately 15% of the transformers. These are the aged transformers that they've been replaced. For the pole inspection, we just completed the second round of the pole inspections, and we have replaced so far 187 poles.
Is that for just 2016?
That's right. Yeah, this is for for this year. We just, you know, did another 670 poles, and the same rate, approximately 30%. They failed the test. Yeah. We had few condemned, and those condemned ones, they immediately were replaced. Wow. And so this is a very good program. Yeah. So we every year, by FDA, under the FDA, the SDA, the agricultural, the Department of Agriculture, they're recommending 10% every year, the 10% of the olds for a 10 years program.
Yeah.
So 110 of the 187 transfers has been completed to date. The next category, visual inspection of the overhead lines. These are the number of lines that, you know, we have inspected as of October 13th, 2016. Manhole inspections, we have completed 614 manholes to date, to the month of August, actually a little bit more in October. Porcelain cutout replacements through the August, we have completed 91%. There are 256 remaining to be replaced. Tree trimming, we've done 110 spans that they've been trimmed so far. Year to date, 176 spans. These are for fiscal year. The substation maintenance, we've done the infrared scanning for the month of August, has been completed. No hot spots were found. The next slide shows the double poles. We have approximately 16,000 poles in the system. The ownership is 50-50. However, the custodials are split between us and Verizon. In Reading, we split 50-50. In North Reading, it's RMLD custodial. Linfield and Wilmington is Verizon's. The next slide shows the engines programs, which shows who has the ownership of what. It's in the ball court, in order to what action needs to be taken for the poles, double poles, and the transfers. For Linfield area, we have 5 transfers. In North Reading, we got 16 transfers, 1 pole to set, and also pulling 45 poles. In Reading, we got 55 transfers and 39 pool poles. And for Wilmington, we got 42 transfers, 4 pool pole, and 1 guy install. So these are basically the number of poles. You see the number of double poles might be. These numbers, they go up and down. We try to keep up with you know, the transfers and taking the poles that as soon as they're done in our custodial area, everybody's transferred, taking them out. And it's a dynamic process. So with the programs we have for maintenance and for the capital improvement projects, it might, you know, you might see that number increases. So,
yep.
But we try to keep up with the transfers and double pole removal.
Yep.
The next slide, this is the last one. This shows the reliability indices. Basically, the KD, we are well below the national and regional average. In the SADE and SAFE area, we're slightly over the regional, but we're well over under the national indices. And the reason for those is whenever you have a storm or the trees are coming down, tree incidents or vehicle is hitting the pole, if it's a main line, you're going to see more outages, more customers being out. So as a result, these numbers, they go up. We've had a few of the, you know, incidents that, you know, cause those lengthy outages, and that's what contributes. Also, another thing is the maintenance. because, you know, still we have a lot of areas that, you know, that we need to catch up with the maintenance. And these are the ones that long been overdue. And you see that the results over here, that's why the numbers go up and down depending on the situation and the cause of the faults. The next slide is showing you the cause of the outages, the annual 5 years average in the lower bottom, and on the upper right, upper left, you're gonna see the year to date 2016 from January to August, which for about 25% contributed, equipment contributed, 34% trees contributed, and 29% wildlife contributed. And that concludes my report for engineering and operations. If you have any questions, I'm more than happy to answer them.
No questions from the board?
Nope. Okay. Yes, Dennis.
On the equipment,
right?
The 5 year average was 80, and now it's at 41. So is that a direct correlation to all the replacements you've been doing?
And yes, that's right. It is. This program, unfortunately, you know, we can't go. We got like about 1,800 transformers that they're aged, and that's part of this is the price that we pay for not maintaining the system. The system hadn't been maintained for 15 years, almost 20 years, and unfortunately, there was no program. Now we have a program, and we are addressing those and replacing the aged transformer. Right now, we're getting we replaced most of the 40, 45 years transformers. Now we're getting to more of 30s, 35s. So we've had a number of very hairy situations that, you know, we were able to catch before the oil release and transformer failures and customer aggravations. And we continue going along those lines. And so it's a very good program. And I'm hoping that, you know, we got a lot to do with the next for the next 10 years, because it's not easy replacing 1,800 transformers in 1 year, 2 years. So we are lucky if we can replace 150 a year. So this is like we're talking about 15-year program, you know, in order to catch up.
Yep.
So, and again, this is going back 15 years.
Yeah, that you program can't make sure.
We can't
make up
do
overnight,
it.
So, sure.
You see the pulse of the system going up and down, those SAIDI, KDs, these numbers, but overall we're doing good. The reliability is good. However, you're gonna see those numbers jumping up and down until we get to a stable situation.
Good, okay, thanks, Amit.
By all means, thank you.
So now we have several procurement requests, so Phil's been practicing here.
Okay, I'm ready to go. Wind me up, turn me on, you know. Move the proposal 2017-15 for capacitor bank be awarded to Wesco for $54,480 pursuant to Chapter 164, Section 56D on the recommendation of the general manager.
Second.
Any discussion?
We're going to get a presentation from.
These are the capacitor banks that they stabilize the voltage, basically. We got few in areas that we did a small engineering study without having basically that the GIS model, and we need to install more capacitors. These cap banks, basically what they do, they reduce the system losses, so which is benefit to the ratepayers. I know, you know, they're big, and we put them up on the poles, and it's like the transformers, but really the system benefits from that. So we went out to bid, and this is what the result of the bid was, $54,480. We had allocated $30,000. We're going a little bit over, but the payback would be quick by reduction of the losses.
And it's interesting with all the companies that only one sealed proposal was received. That was I mean, Wesco is obviously well known in the
Yes, we got, actually, there was another one that participated also, Metro West. They sent the proposal via email, not a sealed bid, so it had to be rejected. So that's what happened. Two people, actually, they responded.
Okay, okay, ready for a vote?
Yep.
Ms. Pristina, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
Mr. Talbot, aye.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Okay. Motion carries 4-0. Next, Phil.
Move the proposal 2017-20 for 750 MCM cable be awarded to Arthur Hurley Company for $104,513.10 pursuant to Section 164, Chapter 164, Section 56D, on the recommendation of General Manager. Boy, I really got that one wrong.
Second.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Any discussion?
Presentation.
As you see, the three companies, actually, they bet Arthur Hurley, Okernight, and Wesco. These are the cables that we use for getaways out of the substations. So we need to have those just in case the cables, they fail. As a part of the recommendations made by Booth and Associates, we need to beef up those cables. So that's why we went out to bid and purchased these items. So reliability related.
Just one question. I noticed that the bid is in the name of Arthur J. Hurley Company, Inc. Is
right.
That, do we, and the motion has Arthur Hurley Company. So
right.
Do we have that? Should we say that should be Arthur J. Hurley Company, Inc.?
Yeah.
Okay. So
that's
I
right.
Will
Arthur J. Hurley Company, Inc.
On the motion. So I will make that as part of the main motion. Second.
Thank
agrees.
You.
Okay.
Okay. And great. I will have to abstain from this one because I believe Mr. Hurley is a client of a client.
All right.
And probably contributes 20 cents to my net worth, if that. If that.
Which is already substantial.
Which is dropping if he's watching.
Okay, ready for vote?
Yes.
Mr. Rourke, aye.
Mr. Stempak,
aye. Talbot, aye.
Okay.
Mr. Cino, abstain.
Okay, so it's
3-0-1. Yes.
Okay, next up.
Okay, next up is move the proposal 217-2017-22 for single-phase step voltage regulator be awarded to Graybar Electric for $146,090 pursuant to Chapter 164, Section 56D on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Second.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
Do you need to explain? Okay. Graybar and Power Sales Group, they basically responded to bid. And the voltage regulators, these are like voltage boosters. They work differently than the capacitors. We had some problems, marginal voltages in the Linfield area. And for that reason, some of these feeders, we need to install these regulators in order to regulate the voltage at the end of the line. Hmm. Now with installing those AMI meters, as well as these cap banks, we're going to be able to better manage the voltage and maintain the voltage at the end of the line. Before we didn't even know. I guess we had to wait for the customer to tell us what the voltage is at the end of the line, wait for somebody to call. So this is, we want to be proactive. So to support the voltage, especially during the summer when New England High School calls for 5% voltage reduction. So this is going to help us to be able to support the voltage better for those customers. So very beneficial.
Okay. Ready for vote?
Yep. Ms. Pacino, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
Mr. Talbot, aye.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Okay. Motion carries 4-0.
Okay. Well, the next one. Move the proposal 2017-24 for single-phase submersible transformers be awarded to Central Maloney, Inc. for $19,794 pursuant to Chapter 164. Chapter 164, Section 56D, on the recommendation of General Manager.
Second.
Okay, presentation.
Sure, these are the basically temporary transformers that any URD, underground rural development, that we got these pad mount transformers. When you replace the old one, you need to keep the customers on until you get a chance to do. Some of these, they're really complicated. You have to open up the street, redo the pipes, and you know the cabling here, there. So it's gonna take a couple of days. So these are the transformers that temporarily put them in the hole, the submersible, and so we can keep the customer service on while we're making repairs to make the permanent repairs. So these are very handy, and we need to have these so we can. So because lots of those old URDs that the transformers are old, the system basically is getting out to the end of its useful life. We've replaced lots of those. Hmm. And
so there must be interesting switching mechanisms to hook the
transformer. Yeah, it's very interesting. They temporarily jump the cable.
Yeah.
So the customer has its service. And then you dig and you put the conduits and then run the cables to the secondary handhold and put a transformer in, energize the transformer, and make the connections to the secondary site and remove that. It's like a bypass surgery.
Yeah, bypass surgery. I love it.
That's right.
Any discussion? None appearing. Move for vote.
Mr. Pacino, aye.
Mr. Rourke, aye.
Talbot, aye.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Motion carries 4-0.
Okay, let's go on the next one. Move the proposal 2017-25 for control devices for Station 3 be awarded to Wesco for $62,866 and Graybar Electric for $64,401.28 for a total cost of $127,267.28 pursuant to Chapter 164, Section 56D on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Second.
Okay. Presentation.
The control devices for Station 3 were bid by Graybar Electric and Wesco. This is my favorite project because immediately I picked up when I came on board, I saw some deficiencies at Station 3 and Station 4. Station 4 was upgrading the breakers and relays, and this one was actually improving the substations because the equipment that were purchased, they were from the day that it was purchased, it was really wrong type equipment, and it was obsolete. So now this is going to give us more capability that it's going to be in line with the smart grid initiatives that we have and give us better management of the substation load and SCADA control. So that's what this project is all for. It was also recommended by Booth and Associates. So it's one of those recommendations that it's in progress. So this is basically...
Is there a reason? I mean, in this case, there were two vendors, each got half roughly. Is that?
Yeah, part of because we there are a number of items. It's not one item.
Oh, okay.
There's some of them, one vendor came in, and you know, some the other, so okay. We're splitting.
Yep.
To the best advantage of the RMLD, this is Chapter 164. Yep. So we can pick and choose which one, what product, and which one is to the best interest of the ratepayers.
Yep, good. Any other discussion? None appearing.
Ms. Pacino, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
Talbot, aye.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Motion carries 4-0.
Last one. Move the proposal 2017-28 for one material handler with trade-in be awarded to James A. Kiley Company for $221,715 pursuant to Mass General Laws, Chapter 164, Section 56D on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Presentation.
This is another interesting bid that, you know, it follows under Chapter 164. It's not Chapter 30B. We don't have to go by the lowest responsive bidder by the definition of Chapter 164. Three bidders, Altec, Boston Freightliner, and James Kiley Company, they bid on this. The lowest was the number one, that was Altec Industries. They took lots of exceptions. So that immediately disqualified them. The second lowest bidder was with Boston Freightliner. That was for $228,904. But the problem with this company is that they take parts from different manufacturers and they assemble them together. So the warranty becomes an issue. And whenever you have a problems, you know, they're all going to be crossing fingers, you know, oh, this is this guy's fault, that guy's fault. And, you know, it's not to the best interest of the ratepayers. We don't have time to chase, you know, the different manufacturers for the warranty. And especially when it comes to, you know, the main parts like chassis and material, the lifts, aerial lifts.
Yep.
Kiley Company is the only one that has all the parts. In case there is any problems, they make the parts, they assemble them in their own factory, and they deliver. So one-stop shop. When one warranty covers everything, if there is any problem, they come and fix it on site, rather than with the Freightliners that we're going to have to send the employee over there, take the truck over there, or some they have to tow the truck, and it's going to take longer time for maintenance and for fixing the trucks. And, you know, it's overall for $2,000, it was most advantageous to go with Kiley. And they're most reputable truck providers and truck manufacturers in the whole U.S. Mm-hmm. So.
Good, thanks, Amit. Any other discussion? None appearing.
Ms. Pacino, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
Talbot, aye.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Motion carries 4-0. Okay, thank you, Phil. Lots of
Good work.
Requests, good stuff. Okay, so we have our meetings coming up. We have no board meeting in November. We have a town meeting, and we have a short month with Thanksgiving. So our next board meeting is Thursday, December 15th. Mm-hmm. Committee meetings, we have a policy committee meeting on Thursday, November 10th, and a CAB meeting on the 16th of November. And do we need a representative?
Yeah, I can cover that one. So.
Okay, good. Thank you, Phil.
Okay.
Also, you said on the engines meeting at some point.
What?
Yes. Yes, yeah.
Okay.
So, let's schedule that offline. Is that easy?
Yeah. To, it's yeah. You and Dave Talley join.
Right.
Okay.
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 Yep. Okay. So we'll get a meeting notice out on that. I'll check in with you, Jane.
Yep.
Are you making you giving the talk at town meeting or the presentation that we normally give at the November town meeting?
I don't know what I think. What are we doing in that?
Coming? Yeah, you usually give a
yeah.
Usually
brief.
get up and give a quick
rousing speech.
Yeah, give okay. a rousing speech right. and then introduce
can
Colleen.
Can I borrow the solar speech? I mean the committee
no,
speech.
No eggs or tomatoes allowed.
Yeah, the CAB speech that you delivered earlier.
Yeah,
okay, sure.
You certainly can. Yeah. Actually, that may not be a bad place to do that. That may not be a bad place if we don't get somebody coming forward. That may not be a bad place to put that appeal in again, you know? Good idea.
Okay, any other business? Jean, Colleen, Tracy, nothing? Okay.
Okay, you ready for the motion?
We good? Okay, so you're on again, Phil.
All right, move that the board go in executive session to approve the executive session minutes of September 29, 2016, to consider the purchase of real estate and to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Second.
Okay. Roll call vote.
Ms. Pacino, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
Mr. Talbot, aye.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Okay. Okay. Very good.
Meeting adjourned. Thank you.
All right.
I probably won't be able to join the executive session, guys. Is that all right?
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Dave, for
thanks,
participating.
Dave.
Thanks, both. Thanks, all.
Sorry. I didn't all right. get
that. Good night.
Good
night.
Bye. Good night, good night. David.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Excellent. Okay. You too. Yeah.
Dennis, thank
trying
you.
To think of someone who might be a good representative as well. Then.
This one right
yeah, because we're yeah. talking if something happened to one of us.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And we're down to three, and then
it's not good.
Yeah. Especially between covering these meetings and then
right.
our own.
Yeah.
No, this
yeah.
is for the
yeah. Yeah. And you want someone representing each town.
Of course.
This is for the
right, well, so.
This is as of 10/9. This is
yeah, but from
this is for the year.